Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Today is a wonderful feast. I have been waiting for this feast, not simply because I have shrimp and fish coming out of my ears by now, but because we get to celebrate the culmination of two of the greatest lives of Christians. Today we're going to commemorate Saint Peter being crucified upside down by choice, and the other one was beheaded on a place called Tres Fontanes or something like that, which means three fountains. They say that's the place where his head rolled three times. Now, to a non-believer, that might seem kind of gruesome that you're celebrating a crucifixion and a beheading. But for us, the honor of today is the crowning of the death for the incredible lives of dedication that these people lived. I was originally going to talk about St. Peter and St. Paul. And I was writing about St. Peter and I realized I don't have enough time to do St. Paul. And St. Paul, for me, could be quite a while. But I wanted to see how God could change them into living stones. Isn't that our campaign? We're the Living Stones campaign. And it's amazing because St. Peter, his name was Simon, and he received the name Peter, which is rock, by our master. But you know what's interesting? He didn't receive that name because of who he was. He received that name because of who he would become after being in the hands of the master, after being molded and chiseled and formed into the stone that he eventually would be, one of the pillars of the church. And it's Saint Peter who gave us the title of our campaign, Living Stones Campaign, based on what he wrote in his epistle. And Saint Peter is the one who says to us, I want you as living stones to come to the living stone, the one who is precious. I'm going to get back to that in the end. Now Saint Peter, he was originally a stone in the rough. He did not start off as a saint. He actually exemplifies this verse in 1 Corinthians. For you see your calling, brethren, your calling, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, that it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. I thank God for the example of Saint Peter in the Bible. Of all the people in the Bible, I feel every time I come to a story, he's probably the one I relate to more than anyone. Besides the fact that he was married, he had his shining moments. He was a leader in the church. He had courage. He had boldness. He had some amazing events. The fact that you could walk down the street and the mere shadow of St. Peter would heal people and raise them from the dead. He was truly a glorious person. But that's not how he started off. We see that he had a temper, which I have been accused of on occasion. He says things that he regretted, which I've done maybe once. When the book comes out of my life, then you can read it. He had a desire to be a great leader, but he had his own weaknesses. He had his own fears. He was very impatient. He was very impulsive. He confesses among the disciples while Christ is having a gathering with them, who do men say that I am? It's amazing. Some are saying, some say you're Jeremiah and some say you're the prophet. And then he says, who do you say that I am? All the other disciples didn't say anything. Somehow St. Peter of all, he says, you are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. I mean, that is incredible for him. And God, and Christ says, God has revealed this to you, and it is on this faith that I will build my church, and you will receive the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And then in the same conversation, Christ says, and I'm going to go to Jerusalem, and they're going to crucify me. And he's like, no, I won't let it happen. And then Christ says to him what? Get behind me, not Simon, Satan. get behind me. To go from, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, to being called Satan in the very next sentence, that's pretty bad. Christ tells the disciples on another time, I will be captured, I'll be taken away, everyone is going to leave me alone. St. Peter's like, oh, I'm not going to leave you. I mean, even if all the others, I would never leave you. And then Christ tells him, you know, Peter, Satan asked me because he wants to sift you as wheat, and I prayed for you. But not only are you not going to leave me, you're going to leave me, but you're also going to deny me. There's no doubt about it, he had his weak moments. So why do we hear so much about St. Peter? Why was he the leader of the apostles? I began to think about this, and there's so many reasons, but I wanted to talk about two important qualities of St. Peter. When I think of St. Peter, these are two things I think of. Number one, he was willing to be led by Christ. And number two, he was loyal to his leader. He was willing to be led, and he was loyal to his leader. Now, St. Peter is known for several episodes in the Bible. When you think about St. Peter, you think about these. Some of them are when he's fishing, living a time of unknown, or some distance from Christ after the resurrection, or the very first time. Each time Christ comes to him, shows him that he is truly God. He fills his boat with fish two times. And after seeing his boat filled with fish, by nothing less than a divine act, St. Peter leaves everything behind. On two situations, he sees something in Christ, and he says, you know what? I need to leave everything, and I'm willing to go and follow him wherever he takes me. Even on the boat in the lake, in the middle of the night, the huge storm, waves. I mean, those of you who are men who are on our fishing trip, you know what it's like to be in huge waves that could topple the boat. How terrifying that could be for others, you know, but some reason of all the disciples, he's willing to go into that. I don't understand. Why would you, of all things, why would you get out of the boat? Unless you saw that being near Christ and following Christ was going to be better than what you had inside. There was this trust in this leader that no matter what, he would follow. Where Christ was leading, he was going to go. He must have felt that if I was under Christ's guidance, that being under Christ's leadership, I would definitely be in a better place than where I am now. It was better than a load of fish. It was better than a lot of wealth. It was greater than the security of the life that he was trying to provide for his family by his own will. He knew that he was under the instruction of Jesus Christ. He would find later what he calls precious, a precious stone. And I realize that there are many of us in the same exact situation. We're providing for our families, we're taking care of them, and we are living a very usual life. We're running our families, we're deciding for them, but I wonder, what would it be like if we let someone else take the lead in our family? What if we had this great overwhelming desire that Christ wants to lead you as an individual and your family, and that you said, you know what, no matter where he leads me, I want to follow. When Lazarus died, and they told Christ, and Christ says, we're going to go to Jerusalem, and the disciples are like, oh, why are we going to go? He says, oh, because we're going to, he's asleep, we're going to go visit him. And St. Thomas says, okay, let's go, because we're going to die there. You know what? Thinking that they were going to die there, they went. Thinking that they could die, they went. They were willing to go wherever Christ would lead. That it would be better to go with Christ where people are willing to attack us than to be without him in the comfort of our own abilities. What do you think it would mean for us to follow Christ? I don't mean to imply that we're not following Christ. I know that we are. But I want to ask you, from what distance? and to what extent? Are we allowing ourselves to be led by God? Are we constantly looking for the wisdom of God daily to lead us and our families? Are we trusting that His ability to provide food and shelter for our families is greater than our ability? Do we believe that the life that He gives, that intimacy and the knowledge of Him, would be better than what we have now? Do we believe that only He could satisfy our needs? Could He give us the opportunity to live lives of greater purposes? And are there risks in following Jesus Christ? Are there risks in following Jesus Christ? He said, count the cost. When you make a big decision for your family, you always count the cost, right? You say, is it worth it for us to buy a bigger house? Can we afford it? Can we send our kids to school or whatever? You count the cost. When you count the cost, does Christ win or lose as the leader of the family? What is the cost? What is the gain? Have we really felt like we needed to be led even more by everything that He tells us? Or is it we're going to run our lives and we hope that Christ lives around us? We're going to follow, but from a distance. I'm going to come to church, I'm going to read my Bible sometimes, and I'm going to pray sometimes, and that is the extent of my following. For St. Peter, it was, wherever you go, I will follow. And I have to confess, I'm very struck by this concept. I feel like I'm trying to live a good life, but I don't know if I'm trying to follow Christ where He's leading me. Am I willing to go where He wants me to go? Am I willing to serve whom He wants me to serve? Am I willing to do what He wants me to do? Am I willing to give up what He instructs me to give up? Or am I afraid that it won't be good enough for me? Am I afraid that following Christ won't be good enough for me? Being led by someone requires that you follow. It means you put away your desires, you put away your will, you put away your plans, and you obey the one who leads. I'm sure some of you have had work meetings where the boss comes in and says, this is our task, this is how we're going to do it, this is our goal, and he expects you to say, okay. Not only have you been in the meetings, but some of you are the leaders at your job. And when you say something, you expect people to say, okay, whatever you say, we will do. Isn't it amazing how we will do it for our boss at work? Isn't it amazing how we will expect other people to do it for us? But will we ever do it to Christ? Where you say, you know what, Christ, I've been trying to lead my life by myself, and now I want to follow you. I think that's something that we need to think and pray about. Now, as hard as that is, there's another quality of St. Peter that makes it a little bit easier. And I think that's why he was willing to follow, and that was his loyalty. There's a conversation that Christ has with his followers before, not just the 12, he had more followers at one time. These are Jewish religious people that were amazed by the teachings of Christ. They saw the miracles that he was doing. They say, wow, this is awesome following him. And Christ has this real heart-to-heart conversation. He gathers them all and he says, by the way, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no life in you. If you eat my body and drink my blood, you will have eternal life. Now, for a Jewish person who is instructed by the law of God not to even eat the blood of an animal, to hear your teacher say that you are supposed to drink his blood and eat his flesh, I'll be honest, that's a little weird. If that was me, I would have said, I thought he was a good leader. I thought he was a good teacher. I thought he knew what he was doing, but he's crazy. I am not going to follow this guy anymore. And Christ looks at the ones who left, and he looks at his disciples. And St. Peter, I wonder if he's looking, saying, wait a minute, he's blowing our mission. Like, we need them. What is he doing? Didn't he lose faith? And then he says, well, Peter, what are you guys going to do? And St. Peter says this, you have the words of eternal life. Where else should we go? Are you kidding me? He tells you everything that is exactly opposite of everything you've ever known. So you know what? I'm loyal to you. There is nowhere else. What else? Where else could I go? You've got it. You've got the words of eternal life, and I am loyal to you, even if you tell me something that I do not understand. I believe in you. As hard as it is right now, it may go against all that I believe. I'm going to be loyal, and I'll follow, because I know you the best. In the garden of the night of crucifixion, I'm talking about his loyalty. St. Peter does something that, when I thought about it this morning, I thought, this is very funny, but it's also kind of sad. They're coming to take Christ, right? So there's a legion of Roman soldiers. They're coming in their, you know, their helmets, their armor, their weapons. They've got their torches. They're going to take away Christ and maybe the followers, right? They are so outnumbered. They're just like a few untrained people, and they've got, what, two swords? So, in an act of bravery, St. Peter grabs a sword, and he cuts off a soldier's ear. It's like saying, no matter who you are, I am going to try and defend Jesus Christ. You can try. I don't care how big you are, how scary you are. I am going to try and defend Jesus Christ. That was his loyalty. But the funny part is this. I don't know what he was thinking or how he accomplished it. I imagine the soldier was wearing a helmet. He must have been in striking distance. We don't hear of a big struggle. He's got a sword, and striking distance, he swings, and either it hits the helmet and rolls off and he gets the ear, or he swings and all he could get is the ear. I mean, like, the guy's like right here and he swings and all. How do you get just an ear? That's like a terrible shot. I mean, he is not a master swordsman. What were you thinking? And of course, Christ says, before you get massacred, Peter, I'm going to take this ear, I'm going to just put it back and say, put your sword away. But I admire your loyalty. Now people are going to say, Mark, haven't you read the rest of the story? I mean, don't you know what happened that night? I mean, Christ was going to pray in the garden on the stem, and he said, Peter and the other disciples, can you pray? And Peter didn't. He fell asleep. And then later on, it's not the Roman soldiers anymore. It's a servant lady who's trying to just be warm, who calls him out. And he denies three times. I'll say, that doesn't mean he was disloyal. To me, I don't think Peter's heart for one moment ever turned from Christ. Was he weak? He was definitely weak. But his heart, and I'll tell you how I know. Do you think the lady said, by the way, aren't you one of them? He's like, no.
No.
He's like, no, I don't know him. Why are you getting so upset? Because it says he's like cursing and swearing. No, I don't know. Why? He was afraid of what?
Of taking him and killing him,
but also, I wonder, as he was saying it, thinking, I can't believe I'm saying this about the one whom I am so loyal to. Yeah. Like, you can tell how loyal he was, because after he did it, Christ, he wasn't out of the water yet. I mean, he was in hot water still, right? He was still going to be crucified and punished. Peter could have said, forget this, I'm out of here. You want to know what the Bible says? After he denied three times, he hears the rooster, and what does he do? It says, he wept bitterly. Not because of the soldiers, oh, thank God I'm not taken away. His bitterness because he offended the one whom he loved so much. He told him that I would never leave you. He tried to strike a soldier, and I mean, you were a dead duck at that point. And now the servant laid, like, I bet it was him saying, how could I do that to my Savior? I wonder how loyal we are to Christ as well. We all make mistakes, and we all have moments of weakness. We all act rashly. We all say things that we shouldn't. And at times we're self-seeking and we're self-preserving. But do we feel the same remorse over the times that we've offended the one whom we say we love? Do we just let days of no prayer, days of no reading the Bible just go without any remorse? How loyal are we to Christ? Do we even give it a second thought? Now I'm going to round up here because I think there's something else that comes into play. And I think this is the game changer. This last thing, I think, may have been what solidifies Peter's path for the rest of his life. And it's after the resurrection. See, after the resurrection, after the crucifixion, what happens? The ladies go to the tomb. They're weeping. They're going to anoint his body. They get there. He's not there. Eventually, Christ meets them. And then he tells them this. Go tell the brethren and Peter that I'm risen. Go tell all the disciples and Peter. So when Mary comes and tells Peter and John, and she's telling the story, I'm sure Peter said, can you tell me exactly what he said? I'm sure Mary didn't think about it, but she said, go tell the brethren and you. Like, there is a special sense of loyalty from Christ to me. Like, after he knew what I did, he still had a message for me. And if you read in St. Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, where it talks about some of the accounts of the resurrection, it says this, I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received. This is St. Paul talking. Christ died for our sins according to scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. So that implies that not only did Mary go tell Peter, but that Christ came to visit Peter by himself. That after all of this that just happened, he went and he searched for Peter by himself. Could you imagine what that encounter was like when Peter is in his home or wherever he is and Christ walks in? I think we'll never know, but I'm sure Peter felt that he hadn't lost a beat, that Christ came not to chastise, but to show that he was loyal to Peter even more. And I wonder if from that point on, you know, like when they're fishing and then Christ calls them and then he calls Peter out, and then in front of all the other 10, then he says, Peter, do you love me? And Peter says, you know I do. Three times, you know that I love you. He comes to him first to show him his loyalty. And then he says in front of everyone to show Peter's loyalty. Why do we love? Why do we love Christ? Because he loved us first. Why are we loyal to Christ? Because he's loyal to us even more. Peter, when he saw Christ, he must have been embarrassed, but he was overwhelmed with love. And that's why he was willing to follow. He saw something beautiful in Christ and was willing to trust him. His loyalty to Christ was strengthened by the loyalty and allegiance of Christ. So, Peter writes to us this statement after knowing all that he's been through. I'm going to read it to you because this is our theme. In 1 Peter 2 chapter verses 4 to 10. Coming to him as a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes in him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling. And he says, you are a chosen generation, because he realized he was chosen. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you would proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Who once were not a people, but are now the people of God. Listen to this last part. Who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Those are words that Peter is speaking from his own personal experience. I was a dead stone, and now I am a living stone, because I came to the one stone who is precious. And he calls him precious three times. I wonder, what are the things that you call in your life precious? Like, if you think about it, what is precious in your life? You would say your spouse, your children, maybe a pet, not likely. Parents. Those who are close, like when I say what is precious to you, you think of them. When you ask St. Peter, what is precious to you? He's like, precious means the most valuable. And to me, that's Jesus Christ. No wonder Peter was who he was. Say, it's better for me to obey God rather than men. I don't care if you put me in a prison. I don't care if you're going to slay me. I found something that is precious. I can't wait to talk to you about St. Paul. But St. Peter, who's just like you and me, he's the one who moves me. Because he was willing to follow, and he was loyal to the end. And he was loyal to the end because Christ was loyal first. I pray that we could carry the spirit of St. Peter, who is a living stone, and who is the intercessor of our church. Let's celebrate this feast with joy. Glory be to God forever. Amen.
I never read someplace that Jesus appeared to Peter alone, without the ten or the 11.
So, I read it in some of the commentaries, and the interpretation is this one. He says he was, because even St. Paul writes it, he says he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. It's as if like he saw, like when did Peter see him? We didn't hear that he saw him.
He went to the tomb and he found an angel.
But it says he was seen by Peter, like Peter saw him, and then by the 12. It's implied. That was, but see, that's even after. That's even after. Like Christ, like why would you say he was seen by Peter and the 12 if Peter was there with the 12? Does it make sense? It's in 1 Corinthians 15. Let's stand up and pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. My dear Lord Jesus Christ, I thank you so much because you've given me an example of someone who wasn't perfect, someone who had weaknesses, who had fears, who messed up, who said the wrong things at the wrong time. He wasn't patient, he wasn't always courageous, and yet you made something amazing out of him. I pray, dear Lord, that as you touched Peter's heart and you showed him that you were the one true God, that you were the one that was worth being followed, you were the one that deserved all the worship, you were the one that had everything, that among other than you, there's nowhere else to go. As you touched him, I pray, dear Lord, that you would touch our hearts. I pray that those would be sincere words from our hearts, that we would say, where else would we go? That I want you to follow and I will lead. I pray, dear Lord, that you would help us to have courage to trust you, to know you, to yield to you. Help us, O Lord, to be able to say, okay, whatever you say. I pray for every family that we would be put under your guidance, your instruction, and your leading. I pray for this church, dear Lord, that you would inspire us to have hearts of service, hearts of sacrifice, hearts of desiring to be loyal to you, to go and do as you ask us to do as a church. I pray for your mercy, your forgiveness, your blessings, your grace, and the work of your Spirit in each and every one of us. Through the intercessions of Saint Mary, and through the prayers of Saint Peter, Saint Paul, all the apostles, and everyone who has ever loved you, hear us when we call you with one voice as your children, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Through Christ Jesus our Lord. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.